real pleasure to welcome you to today's lecture by the renowned playwright and activist Joshua Sobol. It's wonderful, of course, to see so many Emerson students here today, and I want to welcome other guests as well, including those from Israeli stage. And I want to give a very special welcome to Guy Ben Aharon. I want to recognize and thank members of the Emerson faculty who helped to make this lecture possible. I don't see all of them here, but I'll just name Amy Ansel, who's the Dean of Liberal Arts. Rob Sobol is not here. He's also the Dean of the School of the Arts. And Amelia Bensusen is not here. I don't see Amelia. And then Ria Condora is the Chair of Writing Literature Publishing. I hope they're all teaching. It's particularly meaningful for me to be able to say a few words this afternoon, not only as president of Emerson, but also because I'm a member of the Israeli Stage Ambassador Council. Today's lecture is a perfect example of the value and importance of bringing together diverse disciplines for a dialogue around the arts. The arts bring people together. They connect diverse ideas and disciplines. The arts help us understand the world, and they also connect us to life's most enduring themes. And at their very best, they inspire us. They inspire us for social change, which is what you will hear about this afternoon. We'll hear from Mr. Sobol on using the arts for social justice, which is a most relevant topic here at Emerson, where civic engagement is embedded in our culture and where so many members of our community share a desire to create and to use their chosen disciplines and media to make a difference in the world in which we live. It's now an honor for me to introduce our guest and speaker, a playwright, director, author, activist who's written more than 75 plays. I'm not sure how long you can write 75 plays in a single lifetime. He has directed productions in Germany and Austria and Switzerland and Israel and the United States, and his most famous play, Ghetto, has been performed in 24 countries. Mr. Sobol and his plays have won many, many prestigious awards, including the Israeli Theater Award for Lifetime Achievement and the Golden Medal in the City of Vienna for excellent achievement. It's no stretch to say that his works are known to have an enormous impact on his audiences and the broader community. As the Boston Globe wrote earlier this month, he's always made it his mission to confront some of the most radioactive, those are their words, social and political questions of our time. And so Emerson is very, very proud and grateful to have Mr. Sobol here this afternoon for his lecture, Theater as a Form of Resistance During Oppression. Thank you.
I'll begin with a short history of my way in the theater. I began in the 1970s, rather 1970-71, at the Haifa Municipal Theater. Haifa is an industrial town in the north of Israel. And a group of theater makers, directors, young playwrights, actors gathered together and decided to start a new tendency, a new trend in Israeli theater. Until then, the Israeli theater was basically, and most of the time, reproducing plays that have been successful either on the West End in London or on Broadway, some classic plays and so on and so forth, but it really did not preoccupy itself with problems that were the hot problems of Israeli society. And that group of young directors, playwrights, and actors who gathered together in Haifa in 1970, rather a year before, 1969, decided to go into Israeli society and make research and find out what we can do to bring to the stage voiceless elements in the Israeli society. And the idea was that we in the theater, we have a voice and we have a forum, and we can either use this voice in order to make people just to entertain people, to make them laugh and to make them happy to be there, or we can lend our voice to elements in the society, as I said before, who are voiceless. So my experience in the theater began with a documentary play about old people in Israel at the time, 1970-71. Most of the old people at that time, and by old I mean people who were older than 80. This was the limit I gave myself, because I asked a gerontologist, what is old age? And he said, there's nothing which you can call old age. There is a process of aging. And it starts with the fertilization of the ovary, and it ends up with the death. So he says, this is the process of aging, and along that line, you can define whatever you wish as the old age. You know, if you are 5 years old, guys who are 10 seem to you old. When you are 20, guys who are 30 seem old to you. And at the time I was 30, and I thought, well, 30 is not old, but 40 is already quite old. So I set a limit, I said 80, and over 80. And I went to old people's homes to interview people who were over 80. And the idea was that we don't hear their voices on the stage, and we want to bring their voice to the stage. And at the time, what I discovered is that the old people in Israel at that time were mostly what I would call imported old age, because we didn't have our own Israeli-made old people at that time. It was a young state, a young country. And most of the people who were over 80 were survivors of the Holocaust. And what we found out, what I found out interviewing them, that they were twice uprooted. First of all, kicked out of their countries, of their places where they were born. And secondly, not really possessing the language of the country where they settled, I mean Israel. They spoke German, they spoke Yiddish, they spoke Romanian, Hungarian, Bulgarian, French. And I had to use all my three or four languages which I could understand in order to interview them. So I carried out interviews in Yiddish, in French, in English sometimes, in German. And we brought their, their voices to the stage. And then we thought that together with the American Ball director, Nola Chilton, who worked together with Miss Strasberg at the time in New York, and she came to Israel in the 60s and settled in Israel. And she brought with her, I would say, the idea that theater should deal with social problems. And her main interest was, as I said, as it was the interest of the entire group that settled in Haifa, to bring to the stage people who had no voice. So the second thing we did was to interview people who belonged to the underprivileged classes in Israeli society. These were mainly newcomers or immigrants who came to the country from North Africa, Moroccan Jews, Tunisian Jews, people who came from the Arab countries, from Iraq, from Iran, and also from East Europe, and who arrived to the country in the 1950s and 1960s. I must say that they came to a country which was struck with poverty at the time. Israel emerged from the 1948 war with a population of some 600,000 Israelis after a very bloody war where 6,000 young people were killed. it is 1% of the population. It was 1% of the population and mainly young people. And then within 2 years, from 1949 to 1951, Israel had to integrate 700,000 immigrants who came as refugees to the country, mainly survivors of the Holocaust, and as I said, also immigrants who came from the Arab countries. They arrived to Israel without, almost without anything. They were, they had only the skin of their teeth. The country had to provide with everything, with, first of all, housing, health, education, working places, jobs, which meant to double the capacity of the country to integrate those people who came to the country, and the country was very poor. And then they were, many of them were settled in improvised new towns, which were built in a haste. And by the 1970s, they were still an underprivileged element in the Israeli society. So I went to interview them, the people who lived there, and we came up with a kind of documentary play, a documentary show that brought again the voices of those people who lived in the, what we called at the time, the second Israel, meaning like a second world. The people who lived in the periphery, in the outskirts of towns, in the suburbs, and who were, most of them were poverty-stricken. Now, for that, to deal with those problems, we had to develop a form of theater, which was, we called it documentary theater. The text was based mainly on interviews taken with people, depth interviews, not just superficial interviews, and sometimes trying to find out what was their spiritual life, what was their how they could cope with the difficulties of life in Israel at that time. I mean, this was the basis of my, I would say, my education in the theater, and probably it tinged my the rest of my activity in the theater for many years. And I will make a jump to a certain period in my activity, at least. In the late 1980s, I met an Austrian young director by the name of Paulus Manker, who directed a play, of mine called Soul of a Jew, or Weininger's Night. I will not enlarge about that play. It is a play about a young Jewish Austrian philosopher who in the beginning of the 20th century wrote a book called Sex and Character, in which he tried to develop the idea that every human being, be it a man or a woman, contains the elements of the other sex. So that each one of us is, let's say, could be a man 60% masculine, 40% feminine. A woman could be, let's say, 60% feminine and 40% masculine. And if they gathered, if they created a couple, they would be 100% masculine and 100% feminine, and this would be a good couple. but this was only part of the theory, and then he went on into making all kinds of extrapolations, developments of that theory into the political field and about history too, talking about people, nations who were effeminate and nations who were very masculine. He became a great admirer of the Germanic mentality, and he considered the Germans as the epitome of what is a masculine nation and masculine culture. And for him, Jewishness and the Jewish people to which he belonged were almost the epitome of what is an effeminate nation, a people that cannot preserve their independence, who cannot create a system of law and to abide by it, and who are in a way, doomed to live almost always in a situation of exile, diaspora, etc., and so forth. So I read his, to say another few points about him. After he wrote that book, Sex and Character, he was only 22 and a half years old when the book came out, and it was an enlarged version of his thesis. He converted to Christianity and 6 months later committed suicide. Somehow, probably acknowledging the fact that by converting to Christianity he couldn't get rid of his effeminate character, being a Jew by birth. And anyway, I wrote a play about him. And then, as I said, I met this Austrian director, Paul Smanker, who directed the play in Vienna and played in it the part of Otto Weininger. And we started the dialogue, and this dialogue made it clear to both of us that we are not very happy with the conventional form of theater. With the fact that the audience comes every evening to the same hall, the same auditorium, people sit down, they lean back, and they expect the performance to lull them or to tell them a story or to make them laugh, but their participation in the event is basically very passive. And we thought, what could we do in order to activate the audience, in order to make the audience a bit come out from their passive attitude of sitting there and watching something that is being offered to them from the stage. So the first idea was to try to change the position of the audience and to create an event in which the audience will be moved around, so to speak, but as an audience. So the subject of the play that on which we worked together was a play based on the autobiography of a German journalist by the name of Niklas Frank. Niklas Frank was the son of Hans Frank. Hans Frank was Hitler's Minister of Justice at the time of the Third Reich. And when the Nazis occupied Poland, Hans Frank was appointed to be the ruler of Poland. And he sat in the palace of the Polish kings in Krakow, the Wawel. Niklas was 6 years old when his father was executed as a war criminal, together with the 11 other war criminals who were executed in Nuremberg, in the Nuremberg trials. And Niklas, who is exactly my age, we were born in the same year, the same month, in 1939. He wrote a book called in German "Der Vater" or "The Father," in which he describes his memories of being the son of Hans Frank, of the ruler of Poland at the time of the Third Reich. The book settles a very bitter account with the character of the father and with the family in general. And the Viennese Theatre Festival commissioned from me to write a play about based on the book, and Paul Smanker was to direct it. I met Niklas Frank, he came to my place in Tel Aviv, we sat together, we talked together, he showed me photos taken in his youth when he was 5 years old, sitting on the in the lap of Mr. Adolf Hitler. His stories were, I'd say, gave me the creeps. We wrote together, we developed the play together. Now, the idea was to shake the audience out of their comfortable position in the theater when we want to confront them with the material and with the contents that should be unsettling to them. And what we did was to sit the audience on a kind of platform on the stage, on a revolving stage, which could be brought up and down and lowered and turned in all directions, so that the audience became a kind of a camera. And we defined the audience, we said the audience will have the experience of a camera that doesn't know where it will be moved the second moment. And we played the scenes of the drama, part of them in the auditorium where the audience is on the stage. And we inversed the relationship between auditorium and stage. We played scenes in the cellar of the theater, so the audience sitting there was all of a sudden lowered to the underground of the stage, confronting scenes that took place there, being turned around, being lifted up again to meet another scene which took place at the backstage or so. And it gave the audience, I would say, a feeling that first of all, they don't know where they will be taking the second moment and what will happen when they are being turned in this direction or in that direction. But all this, after we finished with that experience, we thought that we had to push the experience one step further. And the idea was, or the thought that we had was how to make, to bring the spectator to be, to interact really with the subject matter of the show, with the performance. And then we had the idea together, Paulus Manker and I, to take a subject that you cannot exhaust in a normal drama and to write many, many scenes that are not developing, not a linear development from one scene to the other, but they all touch or bring to dramatize different moments of a certain story. And we were looking for a character that, or a story that would be most appropriate for that kind of an experience. At the time, I was very much into reading and listening to the music of Gustav Mahler, the composer. And I read a lot about him, among other things. There's a huge study done by a French musicologist, Lagrange, who wrote three very voluminous books about Mahler, where he almost researched every minute in Mahler's life. And when I was reading about Mahler, what happened to me is what happened to many people who knew Mahler, that his wife, ALMA, stole my attention, and at a certain point became the center of my interest instead of Gustav Mahler. And I wouldn't say that I fell in love with her, but she provoked me very strongly as a woman who had a very stormy life, a very, very life full of movement, full of romance. She was 22 years old when Gustav Mahler was 42, and he met her at some friend's place outside Vienna. They fell in love with one another, he with her, she with him too. She was at the time considered one of the most beautiful girls of Vienna, wooed by many famous people from the Viennese artistic milieu. The painter Gustav Klimt traveled after her, followed her all the way down to Venice in order to get a kiss from her. and the director of the Burg Theater, the National Theater, the Viennese main theater, fell in love with her. And she was a musician. And her teacher of piano, Zemlinsky, some of you may know his name, those who are interested in music of the beginning of the 20th century, fell in love with her. And out of all these lovers, she opted for Gustav Mahler, who was, as I said, 20 years older. He was 20 years older than she was. And at that time, he was already, it was 1900 approximately, he was already the artistic director and the main conductor of the Viennese Royal Opera. So he was a very important personality in the musical life of not only of Vienna, but in Europe in general. And she was an aspiring composer at the time. She wrote already a few Lieder songs. And when they made acquaintance, she made him listen to her songs. And then mother said to her one day, listen, if you want to marry me, or if you want us to get married, you will have to give up your aspiration to become a composer. You have to give up your career as a composer, because two composers under one roof, it is not a good future for a marriage. It will be impossible. And he said, you have to make your decision. If you can consider my music as yours, then okay, then we can think about marriage. She was shocked, but as you can imagine, but after some 24 hours, she decided to give up her calling as a musician and to accept Mahler's conditions for a marriage, and they married. And she gave up composing totally, which has cost them very much, because their marriage became very quickly unhappy, as you can imagine. They had two girls, two daughters, shortly after they married. But Alma, frustrated as she was, and she was a quite an interesting beginner of a composer at the time. So she took to drinking, and she became an alcoholic, addicted to a very special drink, a Benedictine. I don't know if any of you have ever tasted it. It is a mixture of cognac with a liquor made of various kinds of grasses. It is very heavy. And she became addicted to Benedictine. But not only to Benedictine, we will later hear what happened. Every summer she went to a summer resort to recover from her, despair and from her frustration. And in one of these visits to a summer resort in a place called Tobelbad, she met a young architect who was 6 years younger than she was at the time, by the name of Walter Gropius. Some of you may know about him. He had quite an influence also in the building of high-rises in New York at the time. He was a very interesting architect. He was also a handsome young man, and they had an affair. What happened later is that she went back to Vienna after the summer vacation finished, and Gropius sent a letter to her. He came to Vienna, he hung around their house, their mother's place. He sent her a letter, but made a Freudian slip of the pen. And instead of addressing it to Mrs. Mahler, he addressed it to Mr. Mahler. And it was a very passionate love letter. Now, Mahler received the letter, opened it innocently, read it, and was shocked. And then he found out that the young man who sent the letter was strolling there in the street in front of the gate. He invited him to enter. And he said, I leave you alone, the two of you. Alma, you have to decide if you want to go with him or stay with me. He went upstairs and waited, and like 2 hours later, she called him, he went down. And she said, now I'm staying with you. So he said, okay. He accompanied Gropius to the gate of the courtyard, said goodbye. And of course, what happened is that the love affair between Alma and Gropius went on, but in a clandestine way. They had all kinds of meetings in slip wagons and in hotels and in all kinds of places. And at a certain point, Mahler found out about it, He had a kind of breakdown almost, a fit of impotence. He turned to Freud to ask for help. Freud at that time was in Leiden in Holland, and Mahler was conducting his 8th symphony in Munich. So Freud said, take a train and come to Leiden, I will meet you. Mahler came to Leiden and Freud asked him, how much time do we have? And Mahler said, like 4 hours. And Freud said, what? 4 hours? What can I do with you in 4 hours? You better go to a brothel and leave me alone if you have any problems. And Mahler said, no, you must help me. And they strolled on the streets of Leiden. And at the end of that walk, Freud noted and wrote to Marie Bonaparte, who was with him, was corresponding with him, that Mahler accomplished within 4 hours an analysis that it would take other people 4 years to go through. Anyway, what happened with ALMA? Shortly afterwards, Mahler died, and instead of resuming her relationship with Gropius, she had an affair with biologist, and then at a certain point she met the painter Kokoschka and had with him a very fiery affair also. In the meantime, the world war broke out. She wanted to get rid of Kokoschka because he was driving her crazy with his passion. So she convinced him that if he wants to be an artist of his time, he must go to the front, because this is the way to experience the zeitgeist, where things happen. So, and she hoped that she would that way get rid of him. In the meantime, she married Gropius, with whom she reconnected, but Gropius was sent to the French front, and she was a bit bored in Vienna, so she met a young poet by the name of Hans Werfel, who was some 12 or 15 years younger than she was, and she started an affair with Franz Werfel. Gropius came back from the front for a Christmas vacation. After he went back to the front after 2 weeks at home or 10 days, she found out that she was pregnant, but she didn't know if it was from Gropius or from Werfel. Anyway, I'm telling you all this to say that Alma's life was not really a chaos, but it was a very rich romantic life. And I'm not judging her, not at all. And no, really, I mean it. Because she was, in a way, she was a victim of her time, but she was also ahead of her time by giving herself, allowing herself the freedom of having free love with every man who in whom she found interest. And if I mentioned before the Benedictine, as her favorite drink. So at a certain point, she came out with a very interesting remark that there are two liquids worthwhile to take in the mouth. One is Benedictine, and the other one is the sperm of geniuses. So, yeah, don't be shocked. I mean, she had this, she was a very bold lady, and she meant what she said, by the way. Coming back to Paulus Manke and myself, when we were thinking of finding a way to create a form of theater that will call the audience and every member of the audience to interact with the dramatic action, I proposed to take the character of Alma Mahler, and I said I think that her biography offers us a hunting territory where we can find so many subjects, so many dramatic moments which don't grow out of one or the other, but who together form a world which is Alma's world, so to speak. And then I started to write scenes. I wrote some 50 scenes, taken from Alma's life, and we decided, it was 1995 at the time, so it was already 22 years ago, and we started to think of how we will do what we will do with it, and we decided to take a building that offers many, many spaces and to divide these 50 scenes into series of 5 scenes each in each series. So we had a series A, B, C, D, and E, And we had A1, A2, A3, A4, A5, B1, B2, etc. And we played, we decided to play five scenes from the series A simultaneously. My job was to write the scenes so that they were equal in length, and so that they will start at a certain moment and end simultaneously, so that the actors who were involved in these five scenes will end the five scenes at the same moment and go to the series B, so that, let us say, the actress who was in A1 would meet an actor who was in A3, and another actress who was in A2 would meet an actor who comes from A5, and so on and so forth. And they go into this second series of five scenes, so that during the evening we had like 15 hours of drama squeezed into 3 hours of performance, and each spectator was free to serve in that system according to her or his free will. So you could start, we started the whole thing in a dining room where we celebrated ALMA's 117th birthday. We had an old ALMA who represented the ALMA whose birthday we are celebrating, and another three young ALMAs who represented various ages of ALMA Mala. And each, we began it with that celebration in which every one of the young ALMAs and the old ALMA turned to the audience who were there, who were not seated, but standing around them, and saying, if you want to know the real story of ALMA, follow me. The others are imposters, they are telling you lies. Now, the whole thing started with the fact that ALMA wrote her own autobiography. But when I compared her autobiography with the biographies written about Gustav Mahler, about Franz Werfel, about Gustav Klimt, about Oskar Kokoschka of Walter Gropius, I found many points where her autobiography did not match exactly what the biographers of her husbands and lovers wrote, and you couldn't say who was telling the truth, who was telling what do you call it today, an equivalent truth or an alternative truth. So again, instead of judging and saying, well, I know the truth, I don't know the truth, because maybe ALMA tells the truth and the biographer of Gropius's biographer was not aware of certain facts that she remembers. So the idea was to offer the audience a wide scope of dramatic scenes, so that each spectator will find his way through the evening, and at a certain point in the middle of that development, we would gather the audience after 1.5 hours of traveling there and going in all directions, bring them together to a kind of dinner, which we offered them. The occasion was, in that case, Gustav Mahler's funeral, and we invited the audience who were all directed to the funeral to join us together in the dining room, and they were offered a meal, a real meal. Each one could sit with whoever he wanted. And by the way, many people who came as couples or with friends have split up during the evening, and each one went in his direction or her direction. And when they met at the dinner, people started to talk about what they saw. And they told one another stories of things that they have attended, whereas their partners at the table were totally ignored it totally. So that it was a very interesting and very active dinner where people said, you know, she had an affair with him. What are you telling me? She had an affair with that guy. No, this was there, and this was there. And whose son was this guy, was it Gropius' son or Werner's son? And so the dinner became a very active exchange between the members of the audience, where people discussed things. And then we created an event which called the audience to stand up from their tables and start the second half of their journey throughout those labyrinth of sins. We never told anybody where to go. Each one could go wherever he wanted. I met people after, I will only say that we planned 12 performances because we didn't know if the audience will, how they will react. We could expect audiences who were used to buy the tickets and sit down very comfortable to say, what is that? Am I supposed to run around? I don't want to do it. And we could expect a revolt of the audience. But to our great surprise, we found out that the people, it was in 1996, in February, it was the summer of 1996, June, I think, when we opened the show in a place, in a sanatorium, an old sanatorium that was built in the beginning of the 20th century, a beautiful mansion built by an architect by the name of Hoffman, a human steel building, very beautiful place. It was an abandoned sanatorium which offered us many rooms, halls, cellars, and so on and so forth. And to our great surprise, the audience was eager to interact. People were running and running and rushing and going, and the fact that they were given total freedom to find their way in that what I call labyrinth, I said, well, they are probably coming with the expertise of surfers, because it was the beginning of the age of surfing, you know, in the internet. Now you are experienced surfers, all of you, but at the time it was it had to do with some adventure, to surf into links and to open another link within the link and go from one link to the other. So it answered a certain habit which was new for people and which gave them a feeling that they are the masters of the information that they are collecting. They are not being fed information, but they choose the information that they want to receive according to their interest, which has to do with that experience of surfing, yeah, and not being fed the information as it is in the television, for instance. So what happened is that these 12 performances that we planned were sold out immediately, and people put their names on a waiting list. And we found out that we had enough audience for another 25 performances. So we immediately planned another 25 performances in that sanatorium, which was luckily empty. The place was empty, we didn't, and no one kicked us out from that sanatorium. We were mad enough to take it. And after these, we ended up in the first season with 40 performances. And after these 40 performances, people put themselves again on the waiting list, and they said, if you start it the next season, we want to see it again. So we opened the sales for the coming season, and it was, after a short while, sold out. And thus it went for 20 years. Until last year, when we celebrated the 20th anniversary of ALMA, we called it a polydrama. I didn't find any other name for that kind of an experience. Polydrama meaning poly, you know, many, manifold drama. And we played it in, we moved it from Pokersdorp, where it opened, to Venice. It was at a certain point we had performances in Venice, in Palazzo. There, Palazzo was an audio in Venice. Then we moved it to Lisbon, we moved it to even to LA, to an old cinema in LA. Well, we had problems finding many, many places there, but we had spaces, among others, in this old cinema from the 30s. The restrooms were a very nice space where we could also play scenes between farmers' husbands who went there to unload themselves and so on. In Jerusalem, we played it in Jerusalem, we played it in Prague, in Berlin also. And what happened is that after a while we found out that there were people who came and said, you know, I saw it already 7 times. Why 7 times? The guy said, well, every time it is a new experience because I'm seeing scenes which I did not see last time. There was a Viennese guy who said, I don't know if I could believe him or not, that he was more than 70 times to see the show. And he said 70 times and every time it's a new experience. So I started to calculate how many times one could see the show without repeating the same combination of scenes, and I found out that there were like almost 800,000 possible combinations. So I tried to calculate how much time you need in order to see all these combinations. I found out that you needed some 300 years. Which they say that nowadays there are people who are born and they will live 150 years, so they can watch at least 400,000 combinations of that. But why did I enlarge so much about that experience? Because I think the result and the consequence of my experience with the show, with that Polydrama ALMA, was that this is a very appropriate form for what I would call political theater, political and social theater. Why? Because if you take a political theme, which has to do with very complicated facts, a very rich field of events. If you try to squeeze it into a conventional drama, you end up almost always with the old-fashioned Lehrstücke, you know what Brecht called a Lehrstücke, which means a play that is supposed to teach you a lesson. And I think the mentality of our time is that we don't want to be taught lessons. We don't believe in people who teach us lessons. We want to learn by our own means, to choose, as I said, our way to serve in reality and to make up our mind without being directed too much. And I think this is, I accept it because, first of all, I know that I don't like to be preached at, and I don't like to have people telling me you have to see this and that and then that and think that. No, I want to find my own way. I want to discover facts that interest me. I want to go and to open links in the internet if I want to study a subject. And I want to make up my mind. And I think that this form of the surfing polydrama offers the audience and each spectator the possibility to find her way or his way and to make up one's mind about the subject which is dealt with in the polydrama. So if you take, a question of what happens in a certain region of the world at that moment of history. Or if you take the subject of what happens in your country now at this moment of history. Write a conventional play about it. I don't think this is very rewarding. But I think that the form of the open polydrama can interest a contemporary audience, and it can stimulate a contemporary audience. Because what will happen then if you offer the people, you take a certain chunk of political reality, you deconstruct it into some 50 different events, and each event gets a scene which is not too long, because you have to, as I said before, you have, if you plan the evening and you say, well, I want to create an evening of 3 hours or 4 hours or so, and I need these 50 scenes or 60 or 40 scenes that will cover the subject, each scene, and you will play it in series, as I said before. Each scene can be of the length of 15 minutes, maybe 20 minutes maximum, and you learn to write, or at least this was my experience, to concentrate the dramatic development of a certain problem into these 20 minutes or 15 minutes of a very dramatic, strong scene. And then you have, during the evening, these 50 or 60 different scenes, and you have an audience that will come out in the middle of the show, in the middle of that, it's not a show, in the middle of that experience, meet together in a kind of dinner, and they will start discussing with one another. Because some people will have seen that, some other people will have seen this. They will come from different scenes. There is not one, so to speak, one truth there. Each scene brings up a problem. It doesn't solve a problem. It opens up a certain subject, it deals with a certain question. So automatically, the people when they gather together, they will start discussing with one another, arguing with one another, exchanging opinions, exchanging ideas. And at the end of the evening, what we, our experience was very interesting. At the end of the evening, after 3 hours of, 3.5 hours of that show, when we finished everything, the people stayed over. They didn't want to go home. Mm-hmm. They stayed there. We offered wine, we offered beer. And maybe this is why they stayed, I don't know. But they stayed to discuss and to talk. And sometimes we had one experience where people stay until dawn with us there, and we had to serve them a breakfast with the remnants of what was left of the dinner. Because they didn't want to go home. They stayed there and they discussed and talked and talked. And it was a very lively exchange between the people. So I think that this form, what I wanted to do is to expose this form to you and to suggest that if you are interested in creating a meaningful political drama, there are many ways, I don't say that this is the only way, but I think this can be a very interesting way to do it. And sometimes you can create the drama not with one writer, but to have a group of writers, so that you have a team of like 3, 4, maybe 5 writers together, and each one gets his scenes that he has to develop. And you would need, but maybe I will leave it to questions and answers, because I think I have gone over my time, isn't it, Guy, I'm afraid. I think that this is a very appropriate form for a team work in the theater. My experience was very interesting. At a certain point, Paulus Mack, who was the director and who played the part of Kokoschka in this polydrama, there were scenes which he could not come to direct because he was busy with many other scenes, and he asked me to direct those scenes. So I said, okay, and I directed some scenes, he directed other scenes. There were scenes in the polydrama which he never came to see because he was busy with his job as, first of all, as Kokoschka, the painter, and then as directing and taking care of the logistics of the whole thing, which is a problem in itself, or which is a job in itself, the logistics. And so I think it is a very interesting form of theater for young people, although Paulus and I, we were not too young when we started that experience, but I'm sure that for young theater people, this can be a very, very challenging form, a very challenging and a very rewarding form, because what you get from the audience, you get a lot from the audience. Now, we learned one more thing, that the audience, when we tried to find out what was their experience, we found out and we told them later on, you will get from the evening as much as you will invest in the evening. If you are lazy and you don't want to run around and you will stay in your place, things will come to you from time to time. I mean, I seen here, I seen there, but it will not be at all like the experience that you will have if you will become active, and if you will go, and you will go according to your interest. So again, we told the audience, the more active you will be, and the more will your experience become rich after the evening. So this is what I wanted to share with you. And now if you have questions or if you have
questions,
please ask, I will be happy to answer. Thank you.
This is a great moment of time to become an active audience. So we've got microphones on both ends of the aisles. If people have thoughts or questions, things they're writing to you, yeah.
Hello. I was wondering what kind of, if you received any backlash for any of your work, and if so, in like what form and how you combated that?
What is the impact, you mean?
Yeah, I mean the impact, but also like the kind of, like, has anyone ever fought you on your work in such a way that's been like threatening, and then how have you gone against that?
Not with that work, I must say. I had such an experience with other forms of theater. I wrote once a play called The Jerusalem Syndrome, which was a very critical play about the dangers that fanaticism and zealotry represent for the Israeli society. And this backlash or backfired at me with a very aggressive reactions from some extreme right-wingers. But not with the Polydrama. No, the Polydrama, very interestingly, I think that people, I haven't met people who were against it. I met people who were even frustrated by the fact that they couldn't see in one evening everything. This, yes. They came and said, well, I saw only 10 scenes out of 50. And I paid the full price. I said, yeah, all right, come a second time. Yes, and we were not joking about it. Yes, people who, the ticket we sold was in form of a passport. So if you want to buy a second time, you got a second visa which costs you less than the first passport. You see, a third time if you come in, you get another visa which is even cheaper. So you can encourage people to come as many times as they wish. I didn't get any reaction, no. I'm sorry.
No, don't be sorry, I'm just doing this. Right, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Hi. I was wondering if you thought that the Polydrama could be transferred to a film medium, if you filmed the scenes and then put them in different rooms, if that would have not quite an equitable approach, but that would be an effective way to transfer a story.
Yeah. Well, first of all, it was recorded. We had a cameraman who ran around during the rehearsals and then during the performances, and he recorded everything. We had many, many hours of recording, as I said, and then he edited it into 3 hours of a video film. But it is not the same experience, of course. Of course not. I would say that I would not be very much in favor of filming it, only maybe for the reasons of to keep it as an archive or something right. Like this. But otherwise, it is again, I would very much insist on having a live audience, meeting live actors, and having this live experience of running around a bit and making an effort in order to go through the whole event and then to edit it in their own minds. I had an idea, I can answer you, it's very interesting what you asked me, because I had an idea to develop, to ask the audience to come with cameras at the time. Now you don't need a camera, you can come with your iPhone or your smartphone or whatever you have, and to allow them to record what they see. And then I said we can push it one step forward and to make a kind of competition between the people who saw it, each one invited to edit his or her version of what they saw. And then we can come out from one evening with, I don't know, 200 different films, you know?
Right.
So again, the idea is even to push people, to inspire them to become creative. And this I would say I'm not the Pope, I'm sorry.
Not even just like going through and filming 1-3 hours, but like each scene is filmed, and instead of going to see live actors, you saw a recording scene. Would that in some way still be in the spirit of what you're working
on? It would be a way to probably to experience it. Because, you know, one thing was that we didn't have seats in the rooms, in the different rooms. Each room was furnished according to a certain style. We had like a kitchen where scenes took place. We had a bathroom. We had a lazaret, what is it called, a military hospital. We had all kinds of rooms, and each room, when you enter the room as a spectator, you could find a place to sit if you wanted, on a chair, on a box, maybe sometimes a bench, or a bed. And we did not limit the distance the audience had to take from the actors. So in the instructions we said, you are a camera. Again, behave as a camera. A camera can come as close as it wants to the object. It can take a medium shot, a long distance shot. It can turn around the object. So behave like a camera. So we had, for instance, very intimate scenes. Among others, there was a love-making scene, although it was not consummated, but between Gropius and Alma. They were almost naked, you could say totally naked. On the bed, kind of making love, not really having sex with one another, but making love. And we had members of the audience coming and sitting on the bed and watching it. So it was not forbidden. Others who were a bit more shy kept a distance, and they said, okay, I prefer to have a perspective, you know. So again, the audience became members of they participated in the show. Now, if you have a camera with you and you sit on the bed, you can take a close-up of whatever you wish. It is not forbidden. It gives the members of the audience a lot of freedom. But I say at the same time, that if we take, let's say, a political subject, which could be something like, you know, this political series you had on television here, like the White House or the House of Cards or so, and this is a subject that fits into the form of the polydrama, I think, and then it can be very interesting. We had scenes where the audience were allowed to ask questions to the members, address the actors with questions. We had a guy in a certain in first or second year in Vienna who knew Alma Mahler personally. And he was an old man, he was in his 80s at the time, he was an actor. Now we gave him a room of his own, he was sitting there, people who entered the room and they staring there, and he would say hello. And he would say, yes, I met Alma Mahler, do you want to ask me anything about her? And people asked him questions. And he told them his story of what he, about his experience with Alma Mahler. So you can open up that form of the polydrama in so many ways that you can have an old politician or an ex-president, I don't know, if he wants to participate in such a polydrama, it would be very interesting. If I developed a polydrama about American politics, I would ask Obama, the to participate. And if you would be ready to sit in the room and to accept people who would enter and say hello, I have a question, and Obama would say, yes, I can answer whatever you want to know. You know, I think this is a very, I would say, the most democratic form of theater that I can imagine. Yeah.
Awesome.
So filming, why not? You can film it also.
Thank you.
Yeah,
perfect.
Do you want to come down? Come.
Yes.
Besides ALMA, are there other people that have inspired your works in similar or different ways as impactfully?
Yes. I wrote another polydrama about the composer Richard Wagner. Mm-hmm. You know his music, you know his operas, you don't know. Mm-hmm. Well, it is not a must, I would say. You can if you. he interested me as a character, and his music too, and his operas mainly, for political reasons, because Wagner is considered one of the, he, of course, is one of the pioneers of what is called modern music, you know. In a way, but he was also a very, very bitter anti-Semite. And my relationship with him was very, through his writings, and it was very passionate. And I thought he's a good subject for a polydrama. So I wrote two polydramas about him. I was crazy enough to write two polydramas. One was Wagner in absentia. All the people who had to do with Wagner without Wagner. And he damaged quite a number of people in his relationships with them. And the other one was about Wagner with his relationships with those people. So this was another polydrama that I wrote, and it has a political meaning at least. I have other subjects in my head that have to do with the Israeli reality, but it is a form that needs some heavy support. Because it is not very simple. I mean, to write it is easy. It's not easy to write a play, but anyway, if you have a creative team, and you can create the text. And then it comes to having a place, an installation that offers you all these auditoriums and halls and places where you can simultaneously play, act out scenes, if you understand. So you need a whole apparatus that will support you in doing that job. But I think that for universities, it's an excellent form to develop. And I'm sure that theater department in a university could help to develop such a program. I hear you have a subject in mind that interests you, of course. Yeah, thank you. Yes.
So I read an article that you wrote on The Guardian entitled We Protested the Violence in Gaza, but this time we weren't called traitors.
Yes.
And in this article I was really struck that you talked about producing a play called The Palestinian Girl and kind of like the reaction that got. Like some people returned their subscriptions, a rabbi took down a prayer from the theater door, and a lot of other things.
Mm-hmm.
And I especially like the part where you said that, what was it? I don't pretend that theater can change political reality, but it can certainly contribute to the development of public discourse if only by putting a forbidden word on posters. So I guess my question is, this forbidden word among like other things, like other political things, or what can be considered political in regards to like how close you are to power, what are some like staging practices or like other things that like people have found political or forbidden in your work?
Mm-hmm. Well, you mentioned the play The Palestinian Girl.
Yeah.
It's a play that I wrote way back in 1985. Rather 84, it was performed in 1985. And I wrote that play among other things in order to bring to the stage stifled voices. At the time, in 1984-85, the use of the word Palestinian was almost taboo in Israel. And I belonged to those to that group, I would say, to that to the left wing in Israel, who believe that, first of all, we have to recognize the fact that the Palestinians are a people they have the rights for self-sovereignty, for self-government, for independence, and so on and so forth. So in order to recognize it, you have first of all to admit that the Palestinians exist as a people and not just as individuals who live in the region. So I wrote that play, which had to do with, with the cooperation between Israelis and Palestinians in agreeing about, a common narrative of how to tell us the story. And the play is, to a certain extent, the play itself, which is a play within a play, because it is a play about the production of a television drama, which has the title The Palestinian Girl. And the play dealt with the difficulty to agree about one narrative when you want to tell a story. You see what I mean? So this was that play. At the time, it raised opposition in Israel, especially so from people who belong more to the what I would call right-wing or extreme right-wing. And there were people, members of the annual subscribers of the Haifa Theater, the theater to which I belonged, who insisted on returning their seasonal subscription and to get back money they paid for it. And I tried to convince them to come to see the show first before they return the subscription. And some agreed, but some said, we will not enter a theater so long as the word Palestinian figures on the posters. So, you know, this was the atmosphere at the time. Now, what happened since that moment in our history? Everyone now agrees, first of all, that Palestinians exist, that they are a people in their own right, and that they deserve, they deserve to have their own state, to become sovereign in their own state. And still, there is ongoing, very fierce controversy inside Israel about it. The extreme right wing people don't agree with it, and they think that the Palestinians should live as citizens without the right to participate in the elections. There are some politicians, members of the parliament, who came up with that strange or rather ridiculous idea that you can have citizenship without the right to participate in the elections. So this was one subject which I brought up in my plays. I wrote a few plays about the conflict and about the consequences of the ongoing occupation, which lasts now for 50 years, almost. And this is a subject of controversy in Israel, of course. Yes. Yeah.
Hi. I was wondering, because you talked about using the polydrama with ALMA, which was not particularly political subject matter.
Yeah.
And you did talk about how when you used it for looking at writing, there was more political aspect to that. I was wondering, because you said you did that toward Europe with it. What your experience has been with other people who have been doing this kind of theater, and whether or not you've seen anything equivalent to sort of the polydrama that you've worked on happening right now in the U.S. and in more of the like this side of the pond, as it were.
Yes, I heard about it. I heard that they call it here Promenade Theater or something like this.
I know that there was a show called Sleep No More in New York.
Yes, Sleep No More, I heard about it. Yes.
A similar sort of design to what you talked about.
Yeah, so I haven't seen it, I must say. I heard about it, Sleep No More, but I think it opened some 10 years ago, or when did it open?
It was a little recently. I'm not sure exactly how recently.
Yeah.
It's Is this the right?
Yeah.
Oh, good, good. Yeah, so I was curious whether or not you'd seen anything like that form already happening here, and sort of how you would suggest American theater workers trying to adopt that kind of.
What I said in my presentation is that I believe that it is interesting to use that form for dealing with social and political issues. Of course, you can use the form also for entertainment, but for me, ALMA, the way we did it was not pure entertainment. It had to do with, it had a political edge to it, because it dealt with the right of women to sexual freedom. And among other things, because this is what ALMA is all about. Not all about, but to a large extent, at least what came out from our polydrama. So there were scenes which were still provocative for a contemporary audience in the 90s when we played the polydrama. There was a scene, for instance, that I wrote for the old actress. The old actress who was played old ALMA, she read it. She refused to play the scene. She refused. She said, "No, it is beyond what I can accept." And we had to pass the scene on to a character in the play who was called the Almaniac. And the Almaniac was a man who was crazy about ALMA, who was almost. Became a kind of maniacally obsessed with the character of ALMA, and who wanted to be ALMA, but he was a man. So, when the actress refused to play that scene, I came to him and I said, "Will you?" His name is Albert Kitzel. I said, "Albert, would you like to play the scene?" He said, "Of course, yes." he said, "But I need." Breasts for the so we arranged for him breasts, and he played the scene with great gusto. So the scene in itself was a bit, I would say, the edge of what the actress was ready to words that she was ready to take in her mouth, although she had to quote ALMA about the Benedictine sparrow. But this was another story. Yeah.
Great.
Yeah, thank you. Yes?
This performance that we're talking about is very non-linear and works around the audience not knowing information about this story. I want to ask, why did you decide to do that with this story in particular, and why would a writer or a director decide to work with the audience not knowing certain tidbits of the story?
You mean, why did I decide to work with the story of ALMA?
Why did you decide to format it in a way in which the audience doesn't know certain tidbits about her life? Why did you decide to do this in a non-linear fashion?
Yeah, because I believe that I believe very much in casting doubt about things that pretend to be absolute truth, or pretend to be, at least reach a status of authoritative truth, you know. And I think that if you go into a biography of any person, you will find out that a biography is almost unfathomable. It is endless. You can take every moment of a human existence and go into it and blow it up, like, let us say, what Joyce did in Ulysses with Molly Bloom lying in bed and having that kind of inner monologue which lasts maybe 1 minute, but it is 30 or 40 pages at the end of the book. So you can take every moment in a life and blow it up. I think it has to do with the idea that that again that we are not dealing only with truth. We are dealing with becoming involved in the subject, getting interested, getting interacting with another person, with interacting with a subject that you want to influence and to be influenced by that subject. So I think that this is the philosophy that lies behind the polydrama. That I'm not considering myself as an authority, telling the audience what they should think, what they should see, and what they should experience. Allowing them to experience what they can or what they wish by offering them as much as I can offer. So among other things, it was also the question of, as I said before, you choose the distance from which you watch an actor working. And it's a different experience if you come that close to an actor's face while he's performing, or if you keep that distance between the audience and the actor. So again, it is dealing with, I would say, with the relativity of the human experience when you watch things, when you are attending a performance, when you're, you know, actors ask us during the period of rehearsals before we open the show, for whom am I acting? In what direction should I project? What should I do? Where will be the audience? And the answer was, we don't know. We don't know. The audience may be here, it may be there, it may be around you. We don't know. So what shall we do? We said all you have to do is to be. And you it's not your business to reach the audience, they will have to reach you. And this changed something very important in the way people acted. So there were scenes where people could blow the ceiling there. The scene where, for instance, when Gropius comes, the story with the letter, we acted it out so that he comes to the kitchen and he hears someone knocking on bottles. And he thinks it's Alma trying out her, I mean, clandestinely, her musical talent. And he says to her, Alma, don't answer, you don't have to answer me, listen to me. And he comes out with that confession of his love. Yeah, a very, very passionate confession. And then Mahler pops out from behind the shelves there in the kitchen, and Gropius understands that he made the whole confession to, what he addressed to Alma. It was Gustav who overheard him, and he's shocked. And Gustav says to him, wait, wait. And he calls Alma. They have a kind of a sound system in the house, the way it was by the end of the 19th century, you know, people talked into these pipes, and he said, Alma, there's someone here who wants to talk to you. And she said, I'm coming down. And she left the scene in which she was involved upstairs, and she popped up in the kitchen, and she comes in, she says, yes, Gustavo. And all of a sudden she sees Gropius there with him. And Mahler says, okay, to Gropius, you wanted to speak to her, please say what you have to say to her. And Gropius is dumbfounded, he cannot utter a word. So Mahler says to him, shall I repeat what you said? And he comes out with the monologue that Gropius delivered before, talking for Gropius to Alma, you know. It was, and then what happened is that Alma has a reaction, of course, she explodes. So it was not anymore an intimate scene, it became a very, very violent scene, verbally, and not only verbally, emotionally. Out of this scene, Mahler was running to look for Freud in the polydrama. Yeah, he needed his help. So this was one scene, and there were other scenes that were very intimate, very, very intimate, where you had to go as close as possible to the actors in order to see what was taking place there. So it involves a new aesthetic of acting, also a new way of dealing with acting. Yeah, I don't know if I answered your question. I was carried away.
And thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
And Josh, let's take this last question.
I think it will be the last question. Yes.
Hi. So I was just wondering, in the form of the polydrama, because I feel so much of the progressive political impulse is to get people to experience things that they're usually uncomfortable with. Do you find that there's any times the form of the polydrama being very based around people follow their own interests kind of conflicts with that, because people won't be pushed to experience things that they might be uncomfortable with that they maybe should?
On the contrary, I think that you can create a whole polydrama centering or focusing on a political reality or self-political reality or political question, in which every scene will be uncomfortable and unsettling to people who want to deny a certain reality and who want to suppress a certain reality and don't want to deal with it. And it will force them to deal with it, and not only to deal with it, because one of the things of the polydrama is, as a member of the audience, so to speak, you are not hidden within an audience of a few hundred people. In the room where you attend a scene, you are exposed to other people who attend the scene together with you, and they can be sometimes 12 people, sometimes 20, and sometimes only 2. And we had situations where 2 actors were acting out a whole scene for 1 spectator who happened to pop into the room. And we said to them, the actors asked, if there is no one coming into the room, what are we doing? We said, you have to act as if, use it as a rehearsal for yourselves, but you have to act out the scene, because someone may pop in the middle and he cannot find you there sitting and waiting for him not to come. It was also a question of timing, because as I said, the scenes were timed to start and end at the same moment. So you, as a spectator attending a scene, you were exposed to the same extent as the actors were exposed, and people watching one another while watching what was going on from a very close distance and participating in the same experience, not hidden, as I said, not having shelter within a black room where no one sees anyone. Yeah. Okay, thank you for your
time. I just want to take a quick moment and thank the students and the faculty of Emerson. It was only 5 years ago that I was here as an Emerson student, and it's an incredible opportunity to be able to see all of you engaged in this type of work. And I hope this encourages you to look beyond our borders. At a time when now our borders are going up, I hope you will take them down with your art and look at voices from across the world. Thank you so much.